Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Song. I hope everybody's doing well tonight.
Amen.
I want to share some things with you that the Lord has been dealing with me for the past few days and weeks. And I want to start by reading from Genesis chapter 37, verses 5 through 11. Now Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, "Hear this dream that I have dreamed. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright. And behold, your sheaves gather around it and bow down to my sheaf." His brother said to him, "Are you indeed to reign over us, or are you indeed to rule over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Then he dreamed another dream and told it to his brothers and said, "Behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me." But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, "What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brothers indeed come to bow ourselves to the ground before you?" And his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the saying in mind. Excuse me. So Joseph's brothers hated him, and they hated him even more because he had a dream. And not only they hated him, they tried to kill him. Genesis 37, verses 18 through 21. They saw him from afar, and before he came near to them, they conspired against him to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we will say that a fierce animal has devoured him, and we will see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he rescued him out of his hand, saying, "Let us not take his life." So they wanted to kill him, but the Lord put a stop to it. Mm-hmm. So they sold him. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers listened to him. So Joseph was sold. And then after that, he was sold again to Potiphar. You know, and when he was sold, he was going through a trial. But even though he was going through a trial, God was with him. Genesis 39, verses 2 through 4. The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man. And he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him. And he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. As a result of the Lord being with Joseph, Potiphar was blessed. You know, it says in verse 5, from the time that he made him overseer of his house and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and field. How many people have been, is being, or will be blessed as a result of our favor from the Lord?
Yes. That's right.
You know, think about that.
Uh-huh.
That is a testimony of the goodness of God, and don't you think that that will lead those to Him?
Amen.
So then Joseph went through another trial. And after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Behold, because It says, me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor he has kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And as she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. But one day, when he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was there in the house, she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. But he left his garment in her hand and fled and got out of the house. And as soon as she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled out of the house, she called to the men of her household and said to them, see, he has brought among us a Hebrew to laugh at us. He came in to me to lie with me and cried out with a loud voice. And I cried out with a loud voice. And as soon as he heard that I lifted up my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and fled out. And fled and got out of the house. Then she laid up his garment by her until his master came home. And she told him the same story, saying, the Hebrew servant whom you have brought among us came into me to laugh at me. But as soon as I lifted up my voice and cried, he left his garment beside me and fled out of the house. As soon as his master heard words that his wife spoke to him, this is the way your servant treated me, his anger was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. And there he was in prison. So he was put in prison. Now he was going through this trial. But the Lord was with Joseph. Amen. And showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. Amen. So while he's in prison, he gets this revelation from the Lord to be able to interpret both the chief cupbearer and the chief baker's dreams. You know, his dreams happen as Joseph interpreted them, and he stayed in prison until Pharaoh had a dream. You know, when Pharaoh had the dream, one could interpret, and that's when the chief cupbearer finally remembers him. Oh, there's a Hebrew in jail, you know, where I was, and he was able to interpret my dream. So Pharaoh calls for him. He comes, he interprets Pharaoh's dream, and then he tells Pharaoh to select a wise and discerning man to oversee the land of Egypt because of the 7 years of prosperity and then the 7 years of the famine and all that. And what happened? Well, God showed his favor once again. And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find a man like this in whom is the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall order themselves as you command. Joseph started with a dream. He was thrown in a pit. They were going to kill him. Mm-hmm. He was sold. Then he found favor. Then he was thrown in jail. Mm-hmm. He found favor again. Mm-hmm. Pharaoh called for him. And he was put in a position of authority over all the land of Egypt. Mm-hmm. So my heart has been heavy for the past few weeks. And yesterday, the Lord spoke to me. And he told me that it is time again for me to dream. Mm-hmm. So Joseph had a dream. But God's dream for Joseph's life was greater than Joseph's dream, mm-hmm. because out of that came the Lion of Judah, amen, our God. Savior. Amen. I have a dream. Yeah. It's a big dream, but God's dream for my life is much bigger than mine,
yeah.
and it's going to happen.
Yes.
Do you have a dream? Mm-hmm. If not, it is time for you to dream again.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. All right.
Thank you. That's where I am. And anyone has any prayer requests or testimony they would like to share? Yes, Jody.
It's funny. It's like God is so good. I was reading kind of like you were saying, you kept saying God was with Joseph. God was with whoever else you were talking about. But I read this today. He wanted me to share this, and you've confirmed it. So it says he is present everywhere. Psalms 139, 7 through 10 says, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast." So I feel like I sometimes forget, when we're good, God's with us. Even when we're down in the valley, God is with us.
Yeah,
I feel like he's really wanting us to know that, the Bible teaches he'll never leave us or forsake us.
Right.
It's important in this day and age that we know that he is always, no matter what we, where we are and what we are, he is there.
Amen.
He intercedes for us in the good times. He intercedes for us in the bad times.
Right.
So, the world shouts loud, but we've got somebody that shouts louder.
Yes.
So I just feel like it's so confirming. God is so beautiful. I could have read anything today, and it's like, there it is, confirmed.
Yeah.
So anyway, I just thought I'd share that. Just keep focused on everywhere we go, he is. He's
yes.
in. He's in
mm-hmm.
everything we are. So I don't know if that's encouraging for anybody else, but
Amen.
It is for me.
Amen.
So.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You caught the post about the grace message from a co-house of prayer out in Pennsylvania and stuff, and what the pastor is preaching is, we think, we're the only one getting this and stuff, and it's nice to see that the Holy Spirit is knocking on people's hearts across the land, and here was true evidence with Scripture. Many of the Scripture Pastor Nathan's already revealed these last 2-3 years. On the grace message, and just confirmation. And I know there's gnashing of teeth on people seeing my post on it, but that's okay.
Yeah.
Sooner or later, they'll get it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Keep praying for them.
That's
yes.
right.
Pray for Cindy. She's still battling with the respiratory and things like that. She's doing the medication she's supposed to be doing, and she says it's the weather change. I said, no, it's the unseen things that we're battling
yeah.
and stuff, so we need to stand against this.
Yes.
Get her on her feet.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, come heal.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah, I just want to share, Allison. I was with Allison yesterday, and she said, I was out standing in the yard, she said, the other day, and she said, I looked up at the house, and she said, all of a sudden, it just dawned on me. She said, do you remember Tom Stammen prophesying over me? And I said, no, I don't remember, what Tom told you. But she said, he told me that we would live in the country. We'd have a big house in the country. He said, well, kind of in the country, but yet not in the country. They live in Prairie City. How country can you get? And it would be a big
yellow
two-story house.
I remember
her
that.
House is yellow.
Yes.
And he said it would have a porch all across the front of it. Their
yes.
house has a porch across
yes.
the front of it, and it would all be fenced in, and it's all fenced in.
Yes.
And I love how the Lord does those
yes.
kind of things. Because Allison isn't here, and she needs to be, but
yeah.
those are things he's drawn her.
Yes.
He's given her
yes.
little,
sure.
signs and saying, hey, look what I'm doing for you. Look what I'm, you know.
It is. You know, that's
so
the thing
blessed
about, Tom, you know, I mean, I know there's conflict whenever he's here because that's just Tom. But, you know, there is rarely a service that he has that somebody doesn't get really get a genuine word from God. And I know there's a lot of generalities that, you know, that happen. He's trying to be encouraging and be a blessing, and sometimes he, you know, goes a little bit into things that upsets people. But I, you know, I've watched him every time that he's been here, and there's never been a service that he's been in here that he hasn't nailed it for somebody.
Uh-huh.
Now, everybody may not be getting what they want to hear, but this is an example of what I've heard him also say. Because people will say, well, you know, you prophesied that last time. And he said, well, has it happened yet?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, then it's still there.
Right.
All
right.
This is like the word of God.
That's
it is
right.
A true prophecy coming from the Lord. We want immediate manifestation.
Exactly.
But it doesn't make it not true
right.
Just because
exactly.
It hasn't manifested.
Exactly.
Right. I mean, God spoke things thousands of years
exactly.
Prior to their reality, you know,
right.
in the natural. But it didn't make it any less true, and eventually it happened. So, you know, thank God for people that aren't afraid to still step out and, you know, work in the prophetic area. There's
mm-hmm.
always going to be issues there because it's really easy to get in the flesh and let your own thoughts or attitudes take over. But like I said, he's, you know, he's nailed it on for people in the way. May not be that way for everybody, and sometimes I know he has stepped on some toes, and I disagree with it when he does that. But, you know, we're not, this is not Old Testament, so you can't stone him to death if he misses the voice. For the next one that he gets, right? So, thank God for the Lord and the way he uses people.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, because the promises that you made us are fulfilled. We're only waiting for that manifestation to come to pass in our lives here in the natural realm. Father, we declare your healing to all of those that are in need of healing. Seeing that right now that it's happening, that breathing is right now, we declare that the unseen things are gone in your mighty name, Jesus, and that the healing is manifesting right now. Weapon that is formed against your children going to be prosper. Because we have your spirit dwelling inside of us. Thank you, Father, for the dreams. spirit's moving. It's easier for me now to be able to feel it and know when God is trying to tell me something. On Monday, he was trying really hard to tell me something, and I could feel it. I was sitting on my sofa playing a game with some people, and he's telling me, go to the room and go pray. And I didn't do it. And I regret that. I've been regretting that ever since. But I'm not going to beat myself up for that, because he still talked to me. But I don't know, yesterday I felt like he was inside of me, shaking me. I was talking to Lee and I told her, she's like, I've been there, I'll just hang on to that.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Praise God.
Oh, that's so good.
Yes.
All right, October 9th, a week from Friday, we have our house of prayer in Hebrews 12.
Hebrews 12. Start reading it, soaking it in. We'll probably have copies of the Amplified version. Okay.
All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. The eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes and devours for my sake. And no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for worship team. Thank you all for being here. It makes it a lot nicer when we have a good turnout in the group. Hallelujah. There's more depth of what the Lord wants to do in this place. And I watched the video from Sunday's worship. Roberto, you did an awesome job on Give Him Up. But I think the Lord was taking me off somewhere, because I caught myself watching the video doubling up the ending of lines on the keyboard and stuff. Is like, what the heck am I doing? So I apologize if I messed you guys up, but I was in the zone. I was in the zone. I plugged it in the wrong port.
That's right. You did.
Oh my goodness.
And nobody noticed, that's the worst part. Nobody said anything.
Yeah.
battery is dead. The battery is dead.
There is nothing coming out.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, there we go. Oh, hang on.
Thank you.
Send the fire. instruments might be acting up, Lord, even though the sound system might be acting up, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that we have extra swords and stuff we can pull out, whatever we need to do, Lord. All I know is there's a raging fire that's been building, and I know within the last couple of weeks, even when I was gone, this raging fire is uncontrollable. So if I can start getting weird and stupid and stuff like that, well, I'm not going to say stupid. Peculiar. Yeah, that's the word, peculiar. Just hang with me. Just hang with me. Because I'm hearing things that aren't coming out of this. I'm going to jump to this. If not, I won't play either. We'll just holler out. I don't care. God's wanting to do something new, and I'm hearing it, and I'm trying to tune in on it. Okay? I don't want to hear static. I want to tune in. Okay? I don't want to hear static. I'm tired of the static. Okay? So, Lord, it's all about who you are. Whatever it is, Lord, you want us to do, I just want to make sure we bring glory to your name, because it's not about us, Lord. It's all about you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, y'all get your saddle strapped down tight, because I don't know what's going to happen in these next few weeks, but something's up. Hallelujah. It's the blood moons. The blood of Jesus is shining all over us. You know, they could talk about this and that in the heavenlies and everything else like that, but I know his presence is real. Everything can be going on. They can be talking about the blood moons and Sukkot and all that. And I love what the Lord had done and how everything, all these festivals and everything point to Jesus. So let's look at Jesus. Let's not look at this. Let's not look at that. Let's look at Jesus and the finished work and what he's done. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Join that song, sing one and all. praise, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, we love you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Praise your name, Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Amen. Give them a hand clap. They did a great job. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Prince of the power of the air just tries to get in there and mess with everything going through the airwaves, doesn't he? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you all for being here tonight. Praise the Lord. Let's get right into this so I won't keep you late. I want to talk a little bit more about what we were talking about Sunday, or at least what I was talking about Sunday, and help us to get a real understanding. You know, everything comes out of grace. Everything comes out of the finished work of the cross, and it's all through the Bible. And once we understand how much favor we have with God and how highly he prizes us and what kind of authority and what kind of confidence he has in us to do his work in this earth, we'll understand, I think, what real influence we have and what power we have in this natural realm to change things, and that's really why we're here. I mean, that's the purpose for sending the Holy Spirit and leaving us here as the body of Christ, amen, to accomplish what Jesus started. Now, it's already done. Mm-hmm. We just have to step out, amen?
Yeah.
So it's true of everything. I mean, it's true of healing. It's true of financial breakthrough, prosperity, whatever dreams, whatever visions, whatever purposes God has placed in us, those unctions are by the Holy Spirit to accomplish what God has already declared. Amen? Because everything in here is prophetic. God is a prophetic God. He's always speaking of things that are not as though they are. Amen? Speaking into the invisible realm and bringing reality, bringing his reality into that. So if we are the children of God in his image, then we have the ability to do everything he has said. And the beauty of it is it's not based on our performance, our measuring up to some standard, but it's about his just pouring out this grace to his children so that we can accomplish everything that he has promised. Amen? And it's all right here. Hallelujah. So let's start, Sheila, with Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. Genesis 1:26. Praise the Lord. You know, I'm excited about what God's doing. I thought what Roberto was saying and Jody, how those did come together. Because you're talking about dreams, what God has placed in us, and we have a dream, we have a vision, and it's easy sometimes to think it's just, it's just my dream, that's just something I want, it's a motive that I have, or whatever. But God is there constantly to remind us, amen, that whatever we're thinking, amen, if it's not contradicting the Word of God, then it's coming from God, and he's constantly placing us in situations and circumstances that look counter, intuitively to what it is that he's promised us, because that's the world that we're in. Even like you said, we're feeling good, things are going good, and yet, you're not seeing everything that you expect to see, or things are going horrible, as far as the world is concerned, and you think, my God, where are you? You promised, and so on and so forth. So it's about us understanding our position that makes, you know, I don't want to say makes these things come to pass, but influences the spirit realm so that we see the manifestation of what God has already declared over our lives, individually and collectively as the body of Christ. Because we are the same one way or the other, either together or individually, we're still the body of Christ. So that's the point, and that's what I'm going to try to make some sense out of tonight. So God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Now, I'm not going to get into the Trinity and oneness and all that just for the sake of confusing people. Praise the Lord. It's a lot of semantics and all kinds of things going on there. But the point being, God is a triune God in the sense that he is God the Father, he is the Son in Christ, the manifestation in the flesh, and he is the Holy Spirit. So I don't have an argument with that. I mean, how can you have an argument with it? But they're one. And he has created us in his image. Now, that means several things, but one thing that it means is I have a body. I am a spirit. Amen? So we are triune. We are body, soul, spirit. We have personality. We have character. We have all these things. And yet we are spirit beings, amen, inside of a body.
Exactly.
So we are a representation of this Godhead, the divine Godhead. And so, and there's more to this. Because of that, he created us that way so that we could function as he functions.
Exactly.
Amen? We can just go through our day just being a human, just being a body, basically. Just going through the motions and doing what you got to do. I mean, if you have the kind of, you know, monotonous kind of days that you have sometimes where you just can kind of just go through it, just do it, you know? And there are times when we kind of deviate from that just repetitious, reactionary kind of day to where we become a little creative and we try some different things. And we're still operating in the natural, but we're doing things a little bit differently maybe than we have done it in the past. We just get an idea, we'll try this, we'll do this, we'll do whatever. And then there are times when we are truly tapped in to the Spirit. And everything changes.
Yeah.
You know, even though things may not be changing, everything changes. We know that there's a change. So we operate this way, not because we're all necessarily thinking about it, but it just happens. It's just the way we are, right?
Yeah.
So he said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth on the earth. Amen? So God, he gave man, or he gave Adam initially, which was mankind. It was the way he was, this was about mankind. Amen? So he gave Adam charge of this planet, and he gave mankind dominion over it. Amen? So when Adam sinned, when he ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, first of all, he came into condemnation and guilt because now he's aware that everything he was doing wasn't good. He didn't know it wasn't good before. He had no sin consciousness. He had no, I mean, it was just everything was good. He was innocent.
Right.
So now all of a sudden he has this shame, this guilt, this separation, this sense of separation from God. Amen. And so he sins and he gave. What he did, though, more importantly, as far as God's concerned, his plan, is that he gave charge to Satan. He gave what had been given to us, to mankind, because he was what mankind was at the time. He had the authority. He had the ability to use it as God had intended or to give it away. And that's exactly what he did when he sinned. That's the big issue here. It isn't really, you know, he ate from a tree that he wasn't supposed to eat from. What it did was bring him into an awareness of his humanity rather than an awareness of his relationship with God. And he lost, amen, charge over the earth, over this planet. Amen? Satan got control at that point. Now, what is God going to do? Man had given the authority and dominion to the devil that God had given to the man.
Yeah.
Right? So in essence, the devil became the god of this world.
Yes, he did.
Amen? Now think about it. Originally, we were gods, little g, the creation of God, the gods of this world in his image. Once we gave that authority away, he becomes the God of this world. Look in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4. And I want to show you the logic of God to the degree that I can understand it, but the genius of this. In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. What is that light? Well, it's the free favor and gift of grace that God has bestowed upon us to set us free, amen, from everything and anything. Praise the Lord. So in what we're talking about here, because of this, now it's illegal for God to destroy the works of the devil with his divine Godhead powers. Okay, he'd given, I'm talking about in the earth, because he had given the authority and the dominion to man. When man gave that authority and dominion to Satan, God is not legal to exercise his power, his Godhead powers, his divine powers in the earth. Praise the Lord. So, look at this in Genesis. Let's go back to Genesis again, 1, and we'll read this 26 through 28. Genesis 1, 26 through 28. So, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So, God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And that would be a good sign for everybody to understand that male and female, God is not a male or a female. We are spirits, and we're created in his image, all of us. Male, female, there isn't a hierarchy when it comes to the genders or anything else. That is not a God thing. It's not a Christian thing. That is something that culture has kind of tried to force on people. But God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. There goes my ride. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Praise the Lord. 1 John 3 and verse 8. I'm sorry, I was in a groove here. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Right? So here's the deal. Jesus, by being born on this planet, had legal authority here. He came as a man, the second Adam. That's why he's referred to as the second Adam. So Jesus, we know he healed the sick, he raised the dead, he cast out demons, right? He destroyed the works of the devil. And he did it legally until the day that he died, till he was crucified. Amen? Because he was a man, anointed with the Holy Ghost, right? I mean, if you read in, I think it's Mark 4 or Luke 4, I can't remember now, but he's quoting from Isaiah 61, and he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor and open the blind eyes and so on and so forth, preach the acceptable day of the year of the Lord. Well, Jesus, if you look at his, he never performed any miracles until he was baptized in the Jordan and the Holy Spirit came, right? He was just operating as a man, and after the Holy Spirit came, he was operating as a man, anointed of God or filled with the Spirit of God. Fullness of the Godhead, right? And the Bible says we are complete in him. So he operated as a man, amen, and he destroyed the works of the devil, and he did it legally until his death, right? And once he died, look at John 17, verse 5. John 17, verse 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. So now, he says, Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. All right, verse 11. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee, Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. Praise the Lord. That's being reconciled to God. That's being born again, right? So when Jesus rose from the dead, there was a change that took place. He lost his authority to operate on earth as a man. Amen? He was restored to the glory. That's what he was talking about previously. He had before the world existed. He received his glorified body. He could eat with his disciples and then get up and walk through a wall. Amen? But he was no longer operating as a man. Amen? He was restored to his divine power and glory. And his ministry changed. So Jesus came in the flesh, right? Look at John 1, 1. 1, 1 through 1, 3. Or excuse me, John 1, 1 through 3. Can I make it any more confusing? In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Verse 14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen? So Jesus was given a physical body. He was born into this world, right? Flesh and blood and bone body. Born of a virgin, and God was His Father. So he had a human, a natural mother, but God was his father. And she was a virgin. So God was his father, and there was no sin in him. Praise the Lord. He had the body of a man, and he could exercise authority on this earth because, unlike Adam and all of his progeny or his descendants, he had no sin. Amen? So he could exercise authority on the earth because God had given him or given man dominion over the earth.
Yes. Yes.
Praise the Lord. So God isn't limited in power. But he has limited himself by his own word.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So the church, which is the body of Christ, on this earth today, has the authority to enforce Satan's defeat until we're raptured. Praise the Lord. All right, so John 10, verses 1 and 2. So, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that... Now, this is Jesus speaking. He said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, or listen up. I got something to tell you. I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. Amen? So verse 1 is talking about Satan. It's speaking of Satan. Verse 2 is speaking of Jesus.
Yes.
So verse, look at verse 10 here. The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I'm come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. So he puts the whole thing in context because he's showing the contrast,
yep,
the reason for coming to the earth.
Yeah.
Amen? John 10:10, he says the thief comes for this reason. This is the reason Satan came to the earth, to steal.
Yes, he did.
Amen? To kill,
yeah,
to destroy. I came to the earth,
yeah,
that you might have life and have it more abundantly.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So the enemy's kingdom is darkness, right? All right, John chapter 9, verse 5. As long as I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. Again, this is Jesus. All right, look at Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Well, I mean, what this explains in essence, what everything we've talked about so far, is why Jesus said to Nicodemus, you've got to be born again.
Yes.
You can't enter the kingdom unless you're born again.
Right.
Right? So we were physically born into this planet. That made us legal.
Yes.
But we were powerless.
Right.
Because we're sinners.
Right.
We're the offspring of Adam, right?
Exactly.
So, Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. That is all you need to do the works of Jesus.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
You're already illegal. You already have a legal right to be on this planet. And once you're born again, you're sinless as Jesus.
Yes.
Now, he's your Father. Mm-hmm. And the works that we do are not our works, but the Father that's in us, he does the works.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
If we ever get to the place where we understand that in the eyes of God, when he looks at us, he sees Jesus. He sees us as perfect as Jesus, and he has released his spirit into us so that we can do the works of God, so that we can do the works that were preordained. He even said that works that he had planned for each one of us to do. Amen. So, Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 19. And this is what I was talking about earlier, where Jesus had done no great miracles. He had done no miracles. In fact, the first miracle he did was at the wedding feast, and he had just come from being baptized, coming out of the desert after being tempted by the enemy for 40 days. But he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as a custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, stood up to read, and there was delivered unto him the book, the prophet is Isaiah is what that is, and when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, I can just tell you, that is the mandate. That is the same thing he gave you. He said, we were reconciled to God. This is something God told me years ago, and probably all of us in some way or another, so that we could be reconcilers. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying. The Spirit is upon me so that I can do for you what God wants you to do, to have. Amen. To be reconciled to him. The acceptable year of the Lord. Amen. Where God's acceptance is there. So there weren't any miracles until this point. Now, Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. But you, us, shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost. This is the same thing that Jesus is talking about just moments ago that we just read. Now, he's telling us, like I was, the Spirit of God is going to come on you. The Holy Ghost is going to come on you, and you will be a witness unto me both in Jerusalem. Now, what was Jesus doing? He was being a manifestation of God, or a witness of the reality of God. And you shall be a witness unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Praise the Lord. All right, John chapter 14, verses, let's just read John 14, 12 first. Verily, verily, again he says, listen up, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. All right, verses 25 and 26, same chapter here. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Now, I just throw this out there. There are things that God has said to us that we're not even aware that he said.
Right.
But that's why the Holy Ghost comes to you, Roberto.
Yes.
That's why you feel what you feel, is because God is reminding you of what your spirit already knows.
Yes.
Your spirit is quaking. Your spirit is agitated. It's unctioned, if you will, by his spirit that is one with yours. But your natural mind is having problems seeing and responding to that because it's still kind of, you know, seeing you as less than what you are,
right.
You know. So that's why the dream big.
Yes.
You can't outdream God's plan for you. You can't outdream his purpose for you. I mean, can you imagine anything like doing greater works than Jesus?
Yeah.
I mean, we have a problem with that, even though we know it's the Word of God, because of our finite mind.
Yes.
Because we're still thinking of ourselves as the human that's just better off than we were because now we're saved.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so much more than that.
Exactly.
Amen? All right. So Jesus has access into the earth. Amen? He has access into the earth today through his body, the church.
Exactly. Yep.
You.
Exactly.
That's how he gets legal access into this world.
That's right.
Otherwise, he's illegal. But he's already told us he's not illegal. He's the one that comes by the sheep gate.
Yes.
Right. Why the sheep gate? Because that's the gate the sheep go in and out of.
Yes.
Right.
He's coming in this world in us.
Yes.
But the devil, he climbs up another way. He has to deceive and sneak in or usurp an animal or some way, some means by which he can then manipulate and try to destroy what God has ordained, amen, for him. Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. Now, We tend to think of that as being when he was born. That's not what he's talking about. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith. Now, this is, he's quoting David, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me.
Yes.
That's us.
Yes, it is.
That's what has been prepared. That's the body that he's talking about here. That's in the context that he's speaking here. The only body Jesus has on this planet today is made up of you and I. Praise the Lord. So Jesus is depending on this body for his authority on the earth. Now just think about that for a minute. God has given up his authority to us. The only authority God has on this planet right now, based on his own word, until this is all wrapped up, right? Until Satan is cast out, until we're raptured out of here. Until that time, the only authority God has in this earth, because we're always looking around and saying, oh, God sent the tornado, God did this, God did. God has done everything God's going to do. He has given us his authority, and it's up to us to do the works of God.
Yes.
The same as it was for Jesus.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit had to come and just overshadow people from time to time.
Yeah.
But there was no consistency. There was no assurance of what would happen in any given situation.
Right.
But there is now, if we understand what God has done. Amen. Jesus is depending on us for his authority on the earth. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12. And this is why, to me, this is why grace is so important. Suzanne and I were talking about this Sunday. When you get a revelation. It doesn't have to be a full-blown, total understanding of everything, but you get a revelation about something and you start looking at that and then all of a sudden everything else fits in it.
Right.
Where before, and I'm being honest, before you had to kind of shove stuff in there. I mean, you had to cram it in there to make it work. You know what I'm saying? But you don't have to do that with this. That's the beauty of it. That's how you know that it's God. Everything just fits together, even though you may have seen the scripture and thought of it in one context or one way, and all of a sudden when the revelation comes you go, oh my God. Now it might still mean that, but there's so much more to it. It makes everything else fit.
Yes.
Amen. And so that's the way the Word of God is supposed to be rightly divided, you know, I mean understood in a way that God intended it to be understood. So finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, this is exactly what Mike was just saying. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, we're talking about putting on the whole armor of God. So, you know, we go through the whole list, and we're going to put on my sandals or my feet shod with the preparation of the God. I'm putting on the breastplate. I'm putting on the helmet. I'm getting my sword. This is Jesus.
Yes.
It isn't a bunch of, you know, just random pieces of armor and weapons. It is Christ.
Yes.
So we're looking to you, Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. When we put on the whole armor of God, all we've actually done, and I don't mean to diminish what we've done, but in comparison to that, what we've actually done is just looked to Jesus. We're not, you know, we're not have spent all kinds of time doing a bunch of other stuff. We just were focused on His reality of who we are. We're putting on the mind of Christ. We're actually operating as who we are in Christ. Praise the Lord. Because this isn't about wrestling against flesh and blood, not even our own. This is about principalities against powers, which is what Mike was talking about up here just a moment ago, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He had it exactly right. What do? We're looking at you, Jesus. We're going to worship you, Lord. We're going to pray. We're not going to get distracted by the little nitpicky stuff this the power of the air, the God of this world is trying to throw at us. All we got to do is put on the armor. And He flees. All we got to do is put on Jesus, focus on who we are in Christ, that we are Jesus in this world.
Yes.
He knows it, but He has to be reminded of it. He's had His...
Yep.
He's had His whooping, amen, and he knows that we're the ones that are going to do it, that are going to enforce that whipping, amen.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. But if we don't know who we are, He'll slap us around like a little kid, you know, until you realize. He's like the bully, the playground bully, always picking, always stirring up trouble, always trying to pick a fight, always trying to be a jerk, until somebody finally just says, that's enough, pow. He's just a big mouth.
Yes.
Amen? He's just running around, shooting off his mouth, thinking he can intimidate people into cowing down and backing off so that he can continue to manipulate, steal, kill, and to destroy. Amen? So we don't wrestle against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in high places. Amen? So it's vital for you to know, to understand the authority that you have as a legal resident on this planet. Amen? Born again of the Spirit. You are exactly like Jesus.
Exactly.
Amen? It's just that it happened backwards.
Right.
He was born sinless, but He was born legal.
Right.
We were born sinners, but we were born legal.
Yep.
So we had to get born again.
Right.
So we would remain legal,
yep,
and have authority and have the power that God originally intended to have.
Yes.
Amen? Praise the Lord. So we have this knowledge, this understanding of our residency. We're in this world, but we're not of this world.
Right.
But we're legal in this world. It's like we've got a visa. We've got a passport. We've got a dual citizenship, if you will.
Yeah.
So we're legal here, but we're really not from here.
Right.
But we have every right to be here. But we got way more than everybody else has here. So you want to know about illegal, or not illegal, about aliens? Don't bother watching the History Channel. You are the aliens. We are the aliens. We are the legal aliens.
Yes.
Amen? And we brought with us all the power, all the authority, all of the influence, all of the wealth, all of the health, all of the everything that there is in our home country, we have right here.
Yes.
It's our resource. It's our provision. Amen.
Yes.
We got it coming all the time. Amen. We are to exercise our God-given authority over the principalities, over the powers, over the rulers of darkness, because we are the body of Christ. We are the light of this world. He told us, as long as I'm here, I'm the light of this world. Well, he's not here, but now you are the light.
Yes.
Your light is set on a hill so that the enemy can see it.
Yes.
Amen. He knows.
Yes.
It's a question of whether we know.
Right.
If we're going to let our light shine. This little light of mine. I know we always sing that as a little children, but it's a war song. It's actually a it's like the, mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. You know, he's trampling out where the grapes of wrath are stored. That is kind of a go kick somebody's butt song. Amen. And that's what this little light of mine is really about. It's about letting the enemy know, look, the light hasn't left. The light has been magnified and spread all over this earth now into the believers, amen, who exercise their right, their legal residency right as a human being on this planet, anointed by God.
Yeah.
Just like Jesus did. That's what that was the authority that Jesus used.
Yeah.
No different than us. Praise the Lord. Amen. We got to exercise this. God, the scripture says, God has highly exalted Jesus and given him a name, amen, which is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of beings in heaven, beings in earth, and beings under the earth. Praise the Lord. We are the body of Christ in the earth. And through the born-again experience, we have been made in his image. We've been given a name.
Yes.
Amen. The whole family is named Jesus. The scripture tells us that. Amen. Human body we have without sin and a name to exercise dominion.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
The armor of God is the body of Christ.
Yes.
Woo! Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
We are the helmet. We are the breastplate. We are the sword. We are the feet shod with the preparation of God. We are. That's who we are. And we're thinking about putting this stuff on. It's like I heard Joyce Meyer say one time. All the time we're praying and praying and praying for God to give me this, give me that, give me that. And we already got it.
Yes.
It's like we're saying, let me in, let me in, let me in. And he's saying, you're already in.
Yes.
And we're saying, give me the power. You know, anoint me. Do this. Is this somebody's anointing or somebody else's, you know, impartation? God, listen, we got all the anointing and impartation anybody could ever ask for when we got the Holy Ghost. We have the anointing of God. The Holy Spirit is upon me. For he has anointed me,
yes.
Praise the Lord, to do what I was created to do before the foundation of the world.
Yes.
Think about it.
Yes.
Jesus was with God in the beginning.
Yes.
So were we.
Yes.
Before the foundation of the world, he already knew us, had already declared us, already put things out there for us and put things in us, even though we weren't alive yet. But our spirits, amen, would come into this earth filled with a knowledge of God, filled with an awareness of our power and authority. And that's what we struggle with. That's the frustration that we have, is because our minds are trying to tell us one thing and our spirits are saying we're way too big for this body. We're way too much, amen, for what we have. Praise the Lord. Amen. Colossians chapter 1, and I want to read all this, verse 10 through 22. Colossians 1, 10 through 22. That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Now, we read this stuff and we think this is about performance. This is about me getting to be a better person and getting more knowledge. No, he's saying, wake up. Wake up so that you can walk worthy of the Lord. Worthy of the Lord, what does he mean? We've been made worthy. We've been declared like Jesus. Walk like it. Not talking about being, you know, don't ever say a bad, think a bad, do a bad, you know, but just walk according to the authority and the power that you have, amen, in Christ. Pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Strengthened with all might. How do you do that? Internalize.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
God is in there. He's, like Roberta was saying, he's speaking to us all the time. There is constant communication. His spirit and our spirit have become one spirit. Praise God. Strengthened with all might. Now, either we believe this stuff or it's just what? Cliches, just something to, you know, religiousize. And I mean, if we believe the Word of God, look at what it says about us. Strengthened with all might, according to His glorious power, unto all patience, long-suffering, with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Hallelujah. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by Him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible, invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist. And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have preeminence. Just means He's first. Right. For it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath He reconciled in the body of His flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in His sight. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say, praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. All right, last scripture and we'll close. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. 2 Thessalonians 1, 10 through 12. When He shall come to be glorified in His saints, when He shall come to be glorified in His saints, and to be admired in all them that believe. Yes. Because our testimony among you was believed in that day. Wherefore also we pray always for you that our God would count you worthy of this calling, and fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness and the work of faith with power.
Yes.
Verse 12. That the name of the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ, may be glorified in you. And ye in Him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We still get anxious and uptight about the idea of being identified as a child of God when we really think about what it is God's saying. This isn't just some random, you know, like just a nice thing. I feel like He's like a kid. He's like a child to me. He's like a son to me. No, it's not like a son. You are a son. You are a daughter. You are the offspring of God. Amen. And it's all by grace so that we bring glory to Him through us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. The same way Jesus said, Father, I have glorified You. I've glorified Your name. How? By I've shown the power, the love, the mercy, the grace. Amen. The healings, the deliverance, the casting out of demons, the confronting of the enemy. Amen.
Yep.
And now I'm giving it to them.
Yep. Hallelujah.
Glorify them, Father,
yes,
as I have glorified You.
Yes.
I in You, You in me, they in us.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. There is no difference.
No.
We are the body of Christ. And anything that gets done in agreement with God's declarations has to be done by His body. The only legal representative of God and His power on this planet is you and I. So is it any wonder that God is trying to talk to us? To get us out of our religious kind of boxes and into the reality of this grace where we can walk freely without a sense of guilt and shame every time we do. I heard somebody say this today, and it resonated with me because this happens with me. When we sin, we don't have to go, oh my God, forgive me, Lord. Our sins, God already knows all of our sins, past, present, and future. So we don't have to confess our sins in order to get forgiveness. What we do is we confess our forgiveness. In other words, you do something stupid, something you know is a sin. And then what you do is you don't fall on your face somewhere and go, "Oh God, Jesus, I'm so sorry, I failed you. I'm such a jerk." No. You say, "Thank you, Lord, that you have forgiven me.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, that I am forgiven, that I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Thank you, Lord, that I don't have to dwell on this. I just have to thank you. I'm looking to you, and I'm just so thankful, Lord, that even in my screw-up, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm accepted in the Beloved. I am the most powerful being on this planet. In Jesus' name, I can change everything." Hallelujah. That's how those disciples turned the world upside down in one generation. They went out with an understanding of this power and this authority. And they just did it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And God is expecting the same thing from us. And I think this whole religious cycle has gone full circle so that we could come back to the place and finish the book of Acts.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
And just like it began, it will end with a church of power, spotless, without wrinkle.
Come on.
Not getting spotless, not getting wrinkle-free, but spotless, without wrinkle, in the power and the majesty of His might. Hallelujah. Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Yes,
Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now it's just a question of us doing it. Just step